Fidelio. Fidelio, Opus 72, is Ludwig van Beethoven's only opera. The German libretto was originally prepared by Joseph Sonnleithner from the French of Jean-Nicolas Bouilly, with the work premiering at Vienna's Theater in der Wien on November 20, 1805. The following year, helped shorten the work from three acts to two. After further work on the libretto by Georg Friedrich Treitschke, a final version was performed at the Kärntnertortheater on May 23, 1814. By convention, both of the first two versions are referred to as Leonore. The libretto, with some spoken dialogue, tells how Leonore, disguised as a prison guard named Fidelio, rescues her husband Florestan from death in a political prison. Bouilly's scenario fits Beethoven's aesthetic and political outlook, a story of personal sacrifice, heroism, and eventual triumph, with its underlying struggle for liberty and justice mirroring contemporary political movements in Europe. Such topics are typical of Beethoven's middle period. Notable moments in the opera include the prisoner's chorus, an ode to freedom sung by a chorus of political prisoners, Florestan's vision of Leonore come as an angel to rescue him, and the scene in which the rescue finally takes place. The finale celebrates Leonore's bravery with alternating contributions of soloists and chorus. The work has a long and complicated history of composition. It went through three versions during Beethoven's career, and some of the music was first written as part of an earlier, never completed opera. The distant origin of Fidelio dates from 1803, when the librettist and impresario Emanuel Schikaneder worked out a contract with Beethoven to write an opera. The contract included free housing for Beethoven in the apartment complex that was part of Schikaneder's large suburban theater, the Theater in der Wien. Beethoven was to set a new libretto by Schikaneder, entitled Bestes Feuer. However, this libretto was not to Beethoven's liking. He spent about a month composing music for it, then abandoned it when the libretto for Fidelio came to his attention. The time Beethoven spent on Bestes Feuer was not entirely wasted, as two important numbers from Fidelio, Pizarro's Ha. Welch ein Augenblick, and the duet O Namenlose Freude for Leonora and Florestan, both originated as music for Bestes Feuer. Beethoven remained as a resident of the Theater an der Wien for some time after he had abandoned Bestes Feuer for Fidelio, and was eventually freed from his obligations to Schikaneder when the latter was fired from his post as theater director in 1804. Fidelio itself, which Beethoven began in 1804 immediately after giving up on Bestes Feuer, was first performed in 1805 and was extensively revised by the composer for subsequent performances in 1806 and 1814. Although Beethoven used the title, the 1805 performances were billed as Fidelio at the theater's insistence, to avoid confusion with the 1798 opera by Pierre Gaveau, and the 1804 opera Leonora by Ferdinando Paer. Beethoven published the 1806 libretto and, in 1810, a vocal score under the title Leonore, and the current convention is to use the name Leonore for both the 1805 and 1806 versions and Fidelio only for the final 1814 revision. The first version with a three-act German libretto adapted by Joseph Sonnleithner from the French of Jean-Nicolas Bouilly premiered at the Theater an der Wien on November 20, 1805, with additional performances the following two nights. The success of these performances was hindered by the fact that Vienna was under French military occupation, and most of the audience were French military officers. After this premiere, Beethoven was pressured by friends to revise and shorten the opera into just two acts, and he did so with the help of Stefan von Breuning. The composer also wrote a new overture. In this form the opera was first performed on 29 March and April 10, 1806, with greater success. Further performances were prevented by a dispute between Beethoven and the theater management. In 1814 Beethoven revised his opera yet again, with additional work on the libretto by Georg Friedrich Treitschke. This version was first performed at the Kärntnertortheater on May 23, 1814. Again under the title Fidelio. The 17-year-old Franz Schubert was in the audience, having sold his school books to obtain a ticket. The increasingly deaf Beethoven led the performance, assisted by Michael Umlauf, who later performed the same task for Beethoven at the premiere of the Ninth Symphony. The role of Pizarro was taken by Johann Michael Vogel, who later became known for his collaborations with Schubert. This version of the opera was a great success, and Fidelio has been part of the operatic repertory ever since. Although critics have noted the similarity in plot with Gluck's opera Orfeo ed Eurydice, the underground rescue mission in which the protagonist must control, or conceal, his emotions in order to retrieve his or her spouse, we do not know whether or not Beethoven or any of the librettists had this in mind while constructing the opera. Beethoven cannot be said to have enjoyed the difficulties posed by writing and producing an opera. In a letter to Treitschke he said, "I assure you, dear Treitschke, that this opera will win me a martyr's crown. You have by your cooperation saved what is best from the shipwreck. For all this I shall be eternally grateful to you." The full score was not published until 1826, and all three versions are known as Beethoven's Opus 72. The first performance outside Vienna took place in Prague on November 21, 1814, with a revival in Vienna on November 3, 1822. In its two-act version, the opera was staged in London on May 18, 1832 at the King's Theatre, and in New York on September 9, 1839 at the Park Theatre. Fidelio was Arturo Toscanini's first complete opera performance to be broadcast in the USA, over the NBC radio network, in December 1944, by the NBC Symphony Orchestra, featuring soloists from the Metropolitan Opera divided into two consecutive broadcasts. The 1944 performances were later issued by RCA Victor on LPs and CDs. Fidelio was the first opera performed in Berlin after the end of the World War II, with the Deutsche Oper staging it under the baton of Robert Hege at the Ely Undamaged Theater, the Theater des Westens, in September 1945. At the time, Thomas Mann remarked, "What amount of apathy was needed, by musicians and audiences, to listen to Fidelio in Himmler's Germany without covering their faces and rushing out of the hall." Not long after the end of World War II and the fall of Nazism, conductor Wilhelm Furtwängler remarked in Salzburg in 1948, "The conjugal love of Leonore appears, to the modern individual armed with realism and psychology, irremediably abstract and theoretical. Now that political events in Germany have restored to the concepts of human dignity and liberty their original significance, this is the opera which, thanks to the music of Beethoven, gives us comfort and courage." Certainly, Fidelio is not an opera in the sense we are used to, nor is Beethoven a musician for the theater, or a dramaturgist. He is quite a bit more, a whole musician, and beyond that, a saint and a visionary. That which disturbs us is not a material effect, nor the fact of the imprisonment. Any film could create the same effect. No, it is the music, it is Beethoven himself. It is this nostalgia of liberty he feels, or better, makes us feel, this is what moves us to tears. His Fidelio has more of the mass than of the opera to it. The sentiments it expresses come from the sphere of the sacred, and preach a religion of humanity which we never found so beautiful or necessary as we do today, after all we have lived through. Herein lies the singular power of this unique opera. Independent of any historical consideration, the flaming message of Fidelio touches deeply. We realize that for us Europeans, as for all men, this music will always represent an appeal to our conscience. On November 5, 1955, the Vienna State Opera was reopened with Fidelio, conducted by Carl Boehm. This performance was the first live television broadcast BORF at a time when there were about 800 television sets in Austria. The first night of Fidelio at the Semperoper in Dresden on October 7, 1989 on the occasion of the 40th anniversary of the DDR coincided with violent demonstrations at the city's main train station. The applause after the prisoners' chorus interrupted the performance for considerable time, and the production by had the chorus appear in normal street clothes at the end, signifying their role as representatives of the audience. 4 weeks later, on November 9, 1989, the fall of the Berlin Wall signaled the end of East Germany's regime. Beethoven struggled to produce an appropriate overture for Fidelio, and ultimately went through four versions. His first attempt, for the 1805 premiere, is believed to have been the overture now known as Leonore No. 2. Beethoven then focused this version for the performances of 1806, creating Leonore No. 3. The latter is considered by many listeners as the greatest of the four overtures, but as an intensely dramatic, full-scale symphonic movement it had the effect of overwhelming the initial scenes of the opera. Beethoven accordingly experimented with cutting it back somewhat, for a planned 1808 performance in Prague. This is believed to be the version now called Leonore No. 1. Finally, for the 1814 revival Beethoven began anew, and with fresh musical material wrote what we now know as the Fidelio Overture. As this somewhat lighter overture seems to work best of the four as a start to the opera, Beethoven's final intentions are generally respected in contemporary productions. While some believe that Gustav Mahler introduced the practice of performing Leonore No. 3 between the two scenes of the second act, something which was common until the middle of the 20th century, Cairn states that it goes back to the middle of the 19th century and was therefore a prior to Mahler. In this location, It acts as a kind of musical reprise of the rescue scene that has just taken place. A new, modern-styled production that premiered in Budapest in October 2008, for example, features the Leonore No. 3 overture in this location. 2 years prior to the opening scene, the Spanish nobleman Florestan has exposed or attempted to expose certain crimes of a rival nobleman, Pizarro. In revenge, Pizarro has secretly imprisoned Florestan in the prison over which he is governor. Simultaneously, Pizarro has spread false rumors about Florestan's death. The warden of the prison, Rocco, has a daughter, Marcelina, and an assistant, Jacchino, who is in love with Marcelina. The faithful wife of Florestan, Leonore, suspects that her husband is still alive. Disguised as a boy, under the alias Fidelio, she gains employment working for Rocco. As the boy Fidelio, she earns the favor of her employer, Rocco, and also the affections of his daughter Marcelina, much to Giacchino's chagrin. On orders, Rocco has been giving the imprisoned Florestan diminishing rations until he is nearly starved to death. Giacchino and Marcelina are alone in Rocco's house. Giacchino asks Marcelina when she will agree to marry him, but she says that she will never marry him now that she has fallen in love with Fidelio, unaware that Fidelio is actually Leonore in disguise. Giacchino leaves, and Marcelina expresses her desire to become Fidelio's wife. Rocco enters, looking for Fidelio, who then enters carrying a heavy load of newly repaired chains. Rocco compliments Fidelio, and misinterprets her modest reply as hidden attraction to his daughter. Marcelina, Fidelio, Rocco, and Giacchino sing a quartet about the love Marcelina has for Fidelio. Rocco tells Fidelio that as soon as the governor has left for Seville, Marcelina and Fidelio can be married. He tells them, however, that unless they have money, they will not be happy. Fidelio demands to know why Rocco will not allow for help in the dungeons, especially as he always seems to return short of breath. Rocco says that there is a dungeon down there where he can never take Fidelio, which houses a man who has been wasting away for 2 years. Marcelina begs her father to keep Leonore away from such a terrible sight, but Leonore claims courage sufficient to cope with it. Rocco and Leonore sing of courage, and Marcelina joins in their acclamations. All but Rocco leave. A march is played as Pizarro enters with his guards. Rocco warns Pizarro that the minister plans a surprise visit tomorrow to investigate accusations of Pizarro's cruelty. Pizarro exclaims that he cannot let the minister discover the imprisoned Florestan, who has been thought dead. Instead, Pizarro will have Florestan murdered. As a signal, Pizarro orders that a trumpet be sounded at the minister's arrival. He offers Rocco money to kill Florestan, but Rocco refuses. Pizarro says he will kill Florestan himself instead, and orders Rocco to dig a grave for him in the floor of the dungeon. Once the grave is ready, Rocco is to sound the alarm, upon which Pizarro will come into the dungeon and kill Florestan. Fidelio, hearing Pizarro's plot, is agitated, but hopes to rescue Florestan. Giacchino once again begs Marcelina to marry him, but she continues to refuse. Fidelio, hoping to discover Florestan, asks Rocco to let the poor prisoners roam in the garden and enjoy the beautiful weather. Marcelina similarly begs him, and Rocco agrees to distract Pizarro while the prisoners are set free. The prisoners, ecstatic at their temporary freedom, sing joyfully, but remembering that they might be caught by the prison's governor Pizarro, are soon quiet. After meeting with Pizarro, Rocco re-enters and tells Fidelio that Pizarro will allow the marriage, and Fidelio will also be permitted to join Rocco on his round sign the dungeon. Rocco and Fidelio prepare to go to Florestan's cell, with the knowledge that he must be killed and buried within the hour. Fidelio is shaken. Rocco tries to discourage Fidelio from coming, but Fidelio insists. As they prepare to leave, Giacchino and Marcelina rush in and tell Rocco to run, as Pizarro has learned that the prisoners were allowed to roam, and is furious. Before they can leave, Pizarro enters and demands an explanation. Rocco, thinking quickly, answers that the prisoners were given a little freedom in honor of the Spanish king's name day, and quietly suggests that Pizarro should save his anger for the prisoner in the dungeon below. Pizarro tells him to hurry and dig the grave, and then announces that the prisoners will be locked up again. Rocco, Leonore, Giacchino, and Marcelina reluctantly usher the prisoners back to their cells. Florestan is alone in his cell, deep inside the dungeons. He sings first of his trust in God, and then has a vision of his wife Leonore coming to save him. Florestan collapses and falls asleep, while Rocco and Fidelio come to dig his grave. As they dig, Rocco urges Fidelio to hurry. Florestan awakes and Fidelio recognizes him. When Florestan learns that the prison he is in belongs to Pizarro, he asks that a message be sent to his wife, Leonore, but Rocco says that it is impossible. Florestan begs for a drop to drink, and Rocco tells Fidelio to give him one. Florestan does not recognize Fidelio, his wife Leonore in disguise, but tells Fidelio that there will be reward for the good deed in heaven. Fidelio further begs Rocco to be allowed to give Florestan a crust of bread, and Rocco consents. Rocco obeys his orders and sounds the alarm for Pizarro, who appears and asks if all is ready. Rocco says that it is, and instructs Fidelio to leave the dungeon, but Fidelio hides instead. Pizarro reveals his identity to Florestan, who accuses him of murder. As Pizarro brandishes a dagger, Fidelio leaps between him and Florestan and reveals her identity as Leonore, the wife of Florestan. Pizarro raises his dagger to kill her, but she pulls a gun and threatens to shoot him. Just then, the trumpet is heard, announcing the arrival of the minister. Giacchino enters, followed by soldiers, to announce that the minister is waiting at the gate. Rocco tells the soldiers to escort Governor Pizarro upstairs. Florestan and Leonore sing to their victory as Pizarro declares that he will have revenge, while Rocco expresses his fear of what is to come. Together, Florestan and Leonore sing a love duet. Here, the overture Leonore No. 3 is sometimes played. The prisoners and townsfolk sing to the day and hour of justice which has come. The minister, Don Fernando, announces that tyranny has ended. Rocco enters, with Leonore and Florestan, and he asks Don Fernando to help them. Rocco explains how Leonore disguised herself as Fidelio to save her husband. Previously in love with Fidelio, Marcellina is shocked. Rocco describes Pizarro's murder plot, and Pizarro is led away to prison. Florestan is released from his chains by Leonore, and the crowd sings the praises of Leonore, the loyal savior of her husband. The orchestra consists of one piccolo, two flutes, two oboes, two clarinets, two bassoons, contrabassoon, four horns, two trumpets, two trombones, timpani, and strings. There is also an offstage trumpet. Notes. Sources. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.